Welcome to Research Creations. This video is a full lesson on the GCSE biology branch of plant transport systems, a matter deeply intertwined in the general topic of plants. I will go through the xylem and the phloem, the transport cells and tubules, the root hair cells and the mesophyll cells responsible for water uptake, photosynthesis, and gaseous exchange, the stomata in charge of regulating gas exchange, and the water regulating process of transpiration. These components all collaborate to form a functional and effective plant transport system. Now, let's move on to the two plant transport systems. All plants develop two primary transport systems, the xylem and the phloem. The xylem transports water and mineral ions derived from a plant's root hair cells up the stem and into the leaves. This process is called transpiration. The xylem tubes in a plant are made up of specialized cells called vessels. These cells lose part of their cell wall as they develop, forming hollow tubes to facilitate the fluid transport of water. As a plant matures, these cells die and form non-living tissue. Thus, a substance called lignin is intertwined into the xylem to reinforce and support the vessels, as you can see here. The transport of water in the xylem does not require the use of energy, as it utilizes a self-sustaining physical process, though this physical process constrains transport to an upwards direction. Plants convert light energy into chemical energy in the form of glucose by process of photosynthesis. Growth, respiration, and storage are among the multitude of processes plants use glucose for. The phloem transports this sugar along with derived amino acids dissolved in water from the leaves to the stem, roots, and the other parts of the plant. Hence, the transport of substances through the phloem is called translocation. The phloem is made up of living cells, notably the sieve tubes, which are specialized transport cells with perforated ends that facilitate substance transport, as shown here, and the companion cells, which are connected to the sieve tubes, which provide energy needed to facilitate transport. Since the phloem utilizes energy for transport, it allows for glucose to be transported in both upwards and downwards directions. The distribution of xylem and phloem vessels vary between different parts of the plant. As you can see here in the cross-section of a root structure, the xylem forms a singular support column. The lignin-reinforced tubules support the root structure against the compressive forces of surrounding aggregate or soil. Roots still need a supply of glucose from the leaves. Thus, the phloem tubes are still located outside the xylem. In plant stems, the xylem and phloem are grouped together, with the xylem vessels on the inside and the phloem tubes on the outside, as shown in this cross-section. Each of these units, consisting of one xylem tube and one phloem tube, is called a vascular bundle. The root hair cells facilitate water and mineral absorption for the plant, water being one of the main reactants in photosynthesis. Its long and thin shape, along with its large surface area, allows these cells to reach the small crevices between soil particles and exponentiates the absorption of water molecules. Water is absorbed into the root hair cell through osmosis, the movement of water along a concentration gradient. The water concentration in the soil is higher than the water concentration in the cell's cytoplasm, which is the jelly-like substance organelles are suspended in, vice versa for dissolved mineral salts. This means that the soil water has a higher water potential than the cytoplasm. Thus, the water molecules in the soil will naturally pass through the cell wall and into the cytoplasm. Mineral salts are necessary for cell growth and maintaining a concentration gradient between the soil water and the cytoplasm to facilitate osmosis. This concentration gradient has to stay the same in order for osmosis to work, since moving substances against a concentration gradient requires energy. The root hair cell has to use energy and respire to actively transport mineral ions from the soil into the cell's cytoplasm. Photosynthesis and gaseous exchange are both crucial plant functions, and are both facilitated by the leaves. These leaves are made up of different layers of cells, each with different functions, as you can see labeled here. For this video, we will be narrowing our selection to these two layers, the palisade and spongy mesophyll. The palisade mesophyll's main role is to absorb light energy efficiently. Each one of these cells are packed full of chloroplast, an organelle composed of chlorophyll, and is the site where most of the photosynthesis occurs. These cells are tightly packed and are located right below the upper epidermis. This creates for a greater chloroplast density and maximizes the amount of light energy that penetrates through. Glucose used by the plant is produced right in this very cell because of its characteristics. The spongy mesophyll contrasts its palisade counterpart, as one barely contains any chloroplasts, and the cells are loosely packed together. The reason for this is because of the spongy mesophyll's role in gaseous exchange. The spongy mesophyll is coated in a thin layer of water. Gases involved in gaseous exchange dissolve into this water when they diffuse in and out of these cells. For example, during photosynthesis, high-demand carbon dioxide would diffuse into the spongy mesophyll, while oxygen gas would diffuse out as a waste product. The stomata regulates gaseous exchange in leaves, and on top of that, regulates water loss through transpiration as well. The so-called doors of the stomata are its guard cells. These cells can inflate and contract depending on its water content. The proper term for this is turgidity, the water content of the guard cell. When the guard cells are turgid, the stoma is wide open. When the cells are flaccid, an antonym of turgid, the stoma is closed. In a real case scenario, when the guard cells are turgid and the stoma is open, carbon dioxide will diffuse into the leaf and water will evaporate out of it. Note that the concentrations of oxygen and carbon dioxide will be higher and lower respectively inside the leaf than compared to outside the leaf, as visualized with these arrows here. On another note, remember that the stomata on a leaf are always located underneath the leaf. This is because if the stomata were in contact with direct sunlight, it would accelerate the evaporation of water through those pores. Plants have adapted to develop stomata on the underside of their leaves to reduce overall water loss. When transpiration occurs, the water coating the cells of the palisade and spongy mesophyll will start to dry up. Water from the xylem vessels will have to be diverted to replenish this loss of water. Since water molecules tend to have strong mutual attractive forces in liquid form, this constant need and loss of water acts similar to a pulling force. A constant supply of water from the root hair cells is also required for this process to occur. Though the loss of water necessary for sustaining photosynthesis may seem like a negative, as over 90% of water is lost through transpiration, transpiration is a necessity for the fundamental transport of water for processes such as photosynthesis, maintaining plant cell turgidity as a means of structural integrity. This process also transports mineral salts vital for plant growth, plus the benefit of cooling and hydrating leaf tissue to prevent dehydration. Only 5% of all water absorbed through the roots is used up in photosynthesis anyways, so it doesn't really matter. Transpiration is affected by a wide array of factors, most notably temperature. As we know, increased molecular activity correlates to a higher rate of evaporation. Thus, an increase in temperature causes an increased rate of transpiration. Light intensity. When a leaf encounters more light, the rate of photosynthesis increases. The stomata will naturally open to keep up with this demand of carbon dioxide, leading to more water from the leaf diffusing out and evaporating. Water supply. If the roots were not to provide enough water to reach the leaves and transpire, there would be less water available to evaporate in the first place. A plentiful water supply can easily sustain fluctuating rates of transpiration. Humidity. Humid air has a higher concentration of water molecules. The less humid the air, the higher the rate of evaporation, and in turn, transpiration, as humid air is less capable of holding water. And finally, air movement. Air near to the leaf will get saturated with water molecules as transpiration progresses. If the surrounding area is windy, dry air from the further surroundings will replace the humid air, and we know how humidity affects the rate of transpiration. The more air movement present, the faster the rate of transpiration. To summarize, we can categorize plant transport into two primary modes, transpiration and translocation. Transpiration is the transport of water and mineral ions through the xylem vessels. Water is extracted through the process of osmosis by the root hair cell because of a maintained concentration gradient facilitated by the active transport of mineral ions. This water is either used for photosynthesis or for diffusion out of the leaves to sustain transpiration. This, though, limits transport to an upwards direction, with the benefit of not requiring energy. The stomata can open and close to regulate gaseous exchange and the rate of transpiration. Translocation is the transport of glucose and amino acids dissolved in water through the phloem vessels. Glucose is produced through photosynthesis by the chloroplast contained within the palisade mesophyll, and this sugar is used to sustain plant functions. The phloem tube is made up of cells with perforated ends, and is complemented by companion cells to provide energy. This energy allows for the upwards and downwards transport of substances.